Dear meditators, today I am introducing you one book, The Importance of Vedna and Sampajanya. This book is a paper presentation in a seminar at Dhammagiri Igatpuri in February 1990 under Guruji's guidance. In this book, I found 5 to 8 dhyanas reference given by Guruji. Also, so many scholars, intellects, sadhaks, meditators, acharyas, papers. And again, I found in this book not only 2 Vednas Sukh Dukh or 3 Vednas Sukh Dukh and Asukh Adukh, but many more like Samish Vedna, Niramish Vedna, a monk's sensations and a householder's sensations. Like that, Buddha says that on a particular occasion or according to a particular situation, Buddha says that Vednas are 108. Like that, so many new things I found in this book. And I got an answer that why the Alar Kalam or the Uddhak Rampoot, even though they are master of 8 dhyanas, they could not get liberated themselves. Because in their dhyanas or samadhis, Vedna and Sampajanya is the missing link. So, friends, I am giving you a paragraph out of Guruji's opening remark, discourse. We know that Guruji is a Hindu leader in Burma, Indian leader, who is master of his own religion and Hindu religion, and he talks on Upanishads, Gitas. So, when he joins the course, our Dada Guru Sayaji Ubakhin ask him, do you Hindus have any objection to Sila, a life of morality, to Samadhi, mastery over the mind, and to Panya, wisdom to purify the mind? Then Guruji replies, how could I object? I was pulled like a magnet to his logical, practical, pragmatic, universal and non-sectarian teaching. I had been hearing about and talking about the eradication of defilements and the purification of mind. When I started observing sensations, initially there were moments of doubt. How is this going to help me? Observing sensations. But soon I realized that by observing sensations, I am going to the root of the defilements. I was actually walking towards the goal of full liberation. Whatever Sayaji taught me was not merely to develop faith or to satisfy the intellect, though both are important. He taught me the way to know the truth at the experiential level. If anybody had tried to convince me about the teaching of the Buddha by intellectual discussions, logic or argument, I would not have been convinced, as I was fully satisfied with my own beliefs. What convinced me and gave me here and now results was the experience of the truth through bodily sensations. This tangible tool gave me the confidence that I could indeed become Sthita Pragya, which is the cherished goal of every Hindu. The more I practiced, the more I was convinced that the Buddha was the foremost scientist of mind and matter, Nama and Rupa, the foremost analyst of the truth about suffering and its eradication. And what makes him a peerless scientist is the discovery that Tanha, Trishna, craving, arises in response to Vedna. I had studied the teachings of the Indian spiritual teachers before and after the Buddha, who also accept Tanha as the cause of misery. But for them, Tanha arises because of the sense objects only. They miss the most important link. Not one of them discusses Vedna and its relation to Tanha. They always pronounce sense objects to be the cause of Tanha. Tanha is craving, craving for continuing that which is pleasant, and craving to get rid of or repelling that which is unpleasant. Therefore, Tanha actually means both craving and aversion. The discovery of the Buddha that the real cause of Tanha lies in Vedana is the unparalleled gift of the Buddha to humanity. With this one gift, discovery, he gave us the key to open the door of liberation within ourselves.